Good evening. It's a beautiful evening. I'm Carl Kerner, the president of the board of directors of the Queen's Library Foundation. It's a huge pleasure to welcome you to the Queen's Public Library 2022 Gala. And it's a pleasure for us to all be together in person for a change. We're so glad you've joined us as we recognize the remarkable contributions of four literary stars. With the inaugural Queen's Public Library Award, Jelani Cobb, Jin Lee, R.J. Palacio, and Gary Shteyngart. Each of them is from this amazing borough. Each of them was a regular user of the Queensborough Public Library, and each of them echoes the voices of the people of Queens in their writing. When I was growing up, I visited my local Queens Library branch regularly to borrow books, and that hasn't changed because books and reading continue to be very important to me. What has changed is that libraries now offer so much more, and that is where you come in. By being here tonight, you're helping to support the library's cultural performances, workforce development, children's literacy programs, English classes, and so much more. Just today, in the last 10 hours, here's what happened at the library. A presentation in Bengali on the festivals of Bangladesh. Book clubs in Douglaston, Little Neck, and Hollis. Story times at Far Rockaway, Corona, South Jamaica, Maspeth, Glen Oaks, Far Rockaway, Seaside, my childhood branch, Langston Hughes Library in Rochdale Village, Toddler Times in Astoria, Forest Hills, my adult branch, Woodhaven, McGoldrick, Douglaston, Little Neck, Whitestone, Maspeth, Windsor Park, Poppenhausen, Sunnyside, Howard Beach, South Elzone Park, and Hunter's Point. A virtual painting class for adults and in-person coloring for adults at Bayside. Teen Time to Create at Laurelton. Let's Make Paper Flowers in Kew Gardens Hills, and a virtual origami workshop. The summer reading kickoff event. Virtual Korean for beginners. That's for beginners too. That was only open if you took virtual Korean for beginners one. Wednesday movie matinee at Richmond Hill, a workshop on immigration rights at Woodhaven. A virtual tour of the New York Harbor, cyber skills for adults at Laurelton, computer class for adults at South Jamaica, U.S. Census Bureau recruiting event at Woodside, a citizenship class at Steinway, adult quilt and craft hours at Cambria. I think you get the idea. As you can see, the amount and diversity of programming is incredible, and it wouldn't be possible without the support of friends like you. Let's take a closer look at the many ways that Queens Public Library serves the people of Queens.
It makes me feel calmer, more peaceful, because like it's all quiet at the library.
We play, we read, we have programs.
We can learn English here and make new friends at the library.
The librarians, they all have like the different type of ways to like help me. Since the minute I mentioned college, they actually just was on it. They not gonna give up on me trying to do what's best for me.
Queens Public Library is an institution that's been serving the community for 126 years. We have 66 locations throughout the borough of Queens. Basically, every Queens resident lives a mile and a half of a Queens Public Library, and we are the most diverse borough in the country, and we take great pride of that in Queens. We're the last open democratic institution. We don't ask for their cards, their background, their ID, or anything. They're welcome to come in, sit down, and take advantage of the services that we offer. I think the distinction of the library right now is that we are program-driven in addition to having materials and books and media available for the community. And over the years, we saw the needs to grow for the new immigrants, for people who are looking for educational support services, people who are looking for job, having resume development. We are there to serve their particular needs.
When I came first in this country, came from Bangladesh, the next morning I came out to see around the neighborhood, and I one block after, I found the library. The librarian was there, taught me how to start.
Outreach is a part of the heart and soul of Queens Public Library. It's really going out in the community. We've been doing bookmobile outreach for a very long time. When the bus pulls up in front of a school, and you have kids cheering and excited about checking out a book or getting their first library card, it's absolutely amazing. We service homeless population, veterans, domestic violence shelters, daycares, nursing homes, hospitals. The library has been doing over 100 years working with correctional outreach. We have librarians that go inside Rikers Island.
During the pandemic, we were offering programs virtually, and then we were able to blend in our in-person programs as well. So we tried to adapt to serve the needs of the public. The Queens Public Library has been a lifeline to the customers, being that beacon of hope, being that information source to make sure people knew exactly what was going on. We saw the importance of not just being a library, but making sure our buildings were being taken advantage of for testing site, or vaccine site, to benefit the public. And a reminder of all the lives that we've lost and the tremendous impact that COVID has had on all communities throughout the world. Whether they're people who are moving out of Rikers, whether they're new immigrants coming to the community, whether they're students, you name it, we have it. And our goal is to make sure we continue to grow to serve the variety of needs of the public and making sure that we're here for their benefit.
It kind of pushed me out to be someone that's like, that's gonna change my whole entire neighborhood. Like, I feel like every day I leave that library is like, I'm gonna try to do something great.
Good evening. I am Dennis Walcott, and I have the honor of being the president and CEO of this great institution, the Queens Public Library. And it's a pleasure to see you tonight and to celebrate for the greatest writers working today. And as you just saw, the Queens Public Library is an essential resource for people of all ages and all walks of life. I and the rest of this great staff, and we have fantastic staff who are just so committed to the library, are grateful beyond words for the operating support we receive from so many sources, including the City of New York, as well as the state and federal government. But as Carl said earlier, many of the incredible programs and services we offer would not exist without your generosity and the support of other private donors as well. Each of our library's locations are as unique as the communities that they serve. So we'll be putting the spotlight on four of them throughout the evening: Hollis, Elmhurst, McGoldrick, and our Central Library, each of which has a special connection to our distinguished honorees. First off, let's take a trip to Hollis and learn about our popular hip-hop program and the other resources available at the branch.
Southeast Queens, specifically Queens Village in Hollis and South Jamaica, are the epicenter for hip-hop in Queens and Long Island City. You started to see groups like Run-DMC, who came from Hollis, become national celebrities, getting on MTV. So that all of a sudden brought a light to Hollis.
The library gave me the opportunity to be a librarian and also the chance to speak to my community. So I am taking something from the library and giving back to the community. I'm so proud and so grateful to the library. I have been managing this library for 11 years, so I observe how the community changed. I believe this community feels like somebody is there for them. We do a lot of cultural programs, writing poetry, and we have two book clubs, one in Bengali and one in English. For our young adult, we do have a very good collection of graphic novels. Now it is very popular. And young kids come in, then they can I have their graphic novels. So we take them the notes, and then they come in next day, they found the book, they're happy.
When I go to the library, I just kind of become one with myself in a way, because it's like I'm more peaceful, more calm. I get to let out a little bit more of my emotions a little bit. My favorite series of comic books is probably like the Spider-Man Miles Morales. I can relate to the character. He's Black and Hispanic. I'm actually Black and Hispanic. And he's really like righteous in a way. He's very outgoing. And I really feel thankful to just read those books and find out I'm like somebody that people go off of. Over time, I learned that I gotta be someone that sets things in motion, someone that like helps out the community. More people should like start coming to Queens libraries for sure to get to start learning new things and just to pretty much break out their own shell.
So during the pandemic, we wanted to figure out how we could connect with the community. I said, let me get on Instagram and let's see what happens. And I would start talking to folks and they would just be so happy to just hear a familiar voice. Here's some information about what was happening at Queens Public Library. People like to hear stories that they can relate to. And I try to bring those type of stories. We've had Slick Rick talk about making the transition from being formerly incarcerated into the workplace. We had Damon John come in and do a book talk. And the legacy of a community is so important. Bring this information to the library. It's so important that we tell the story of what hip hop is all about as an American culture.
I feel like learning from other people, it makes you a better person. You're learning that about yourself in a way too.
Jelani Cobb came to this library and read books. He wanted to learn. So it reminds me when they are desperate to use the computer, asking for a book, and then we help them with the test prep. One of them may be like Jelani Cobb. So they will come back and they will give back to the library.
I'm proud that Jelani grew up in Queens, has very much been a successful author around the world, and people can hear his voice, and maybe in his voice you hear some of our voice too.
So let me take a couple of seconds to talk about our first honoree. And I've been waiting to say this, so not just Dr. Jelani Cobb, but Dean-elect Jelani Cobb. So, for those who don't know, he is dean-elect and soon to be, I think in August, he said to me, the dean of the Columbia School of Journalism. So, a gentleman from Hollis, and we are just so proud of him. And he is an inspiration to us all. I was just saying to him that I saw him last week on MSNBC. I read his works, and a true inspiration. A renowned journalist and an historian who was born and raised right here in Queens. Jelani attended a school right up the hill from the Central Library. It's probably one of the oldest, if not the oldest schools still in the borough of Queens, but throughout New York City, Jamaica High School, with one of the most gorgeous campuses of the city as well. And he went to Jamaica, then he went to Howard University in Washington, D.C. He received his PhD in American history from Rutgers University. He has received fellowships from the Fulbright Program and the Ford Foundation. He has taught at the University of Connecticut and at Spelman. Today, he is a director, well, he is no longer the director, maybe in transition, of the Lippman Center for Journalism, the Civil and Human Rights at Columbia. And just a few weeks ago, as I indicated, he was appointed the dean of the Columbia Journalism School. Jelani is well known to the readers of The New Yorker, where he has been a staff writer since 2015. He's a frequent guest on TV. But most importantly, he lives and breathes Queens. He talks about Queens. He's proud of Queens. And Jelani, we're just so proud of you. And it is my great pleasure to present the Queens Public Library Award to the great Dr. Dean-elect Jelani Cobb. Jelani.
I'm going to speak very briefly and say, I will do a quick poll. Raise your hand if you remember your first library card. I accidentally found out how resonant that moment is on Twitter one night when I was up in the middle of the night and I tweeted, "Tell me about your first library card." And I nearly crashed the website. Hundreds of people weighed in and they talked about what their experience was. And I remember that moment when my mother took me to the South Hollis branch and told me to speak up and tell the librarian that I wanted a library card. And for me, as an 8-year-old, I could not imagine, I still am astounded by the idea that there's a place that you can go and they just give you books. You go and you want to read things and they're like, sure, take these books, read them, and bring them back, we'll give you more books. And I found myself immersed. Everything that I did, everything that I've been able to do in some way has flowed from that moment. And so I am deeply humbled and grateful for this award, but I also feel like it leaves me only further in debt to the Queens Public Libraries. And no matter what I do, I don't think that I could ever repay the debt that I owe to the library system. And I would just like to thank you and thank my late mother for having the insight to bring me to that place that day. Thank you.
Hold on. Hold on. Okay. No, you can't leave. For Jelani and the others, we have a gold library card. And this is yours.
Thank you.
Your name is on.
Oh my God.
On the
back. Thank you.
So I'm not sure if you can use it at the Queens Public Library, but
you can brag about it.
You can brag about it and you can put it on Twitter. So thank you for everything that you've done for us, and we'll give you an award. Thank you.
With people coming in here and it being the first place they come when they come to the United States, for us, it's exciting because we're the first friendly face that they see. I think the Queens Libraries are a safe haven.
The New Americans Program was founded in 1977. This program is to assist new immigrants with popular collections, programs, and services in their native languages. The Queens Public Library was actually the first public library in the country to launch this initiative for new immigrants. Over time, the program has expanded its offerings for emerging needs and has served as a model for other libraries. We help them adjust to life in the U.S. as well as our free and safe immigration legal help despite their immigration status.
Every library represents a makeup of the community, so as the community changes and demographics shift, our language collection will change so that they can best represent the people that they serve. So we have a large Chinese section, Spanish, Korean, Tagalog, Urdu. Especially for people who are new to the country, it's a great place for them to come. It's free. They can start building their English language skills, start practicing for the citizenship test, and build confidence in yourself at any age.
2022. I moved here with my husband and my daughter. My friends told me library can help me to learn English. My daughter and I can borrow the American books to study English. And the staff is very patient, always helpful, everything, technology, English, and finding jobs. I love the library because it's my first school in America. I'm very happy to study here, and I make new friends. I passed the life insurance exam. I very appreciate the Queens Library, give me a lot of opportunity.
We also have a lot of success stories with students getting employment from working at a local deli to a bank. We also have students who they start over here and then they end up going to college. The impact is great. It instills confidence in them, connects them to their community.
Especially kids, you see them at a young age coming to the library, stacks of books, love them. They develop their love of reading over time. I had heard that Jin Lee had come to the library as a child, so that's very exciting to see how her love of the library was fostered into a wonderful writing career.
I can relate to her. When I came to this country, you know, you just go to the public library in your neighborhood. For me, Jin Lee, Amherst branch is her first stop to get all the help from the library, and then later on became a famous author. I feel like the bridge between the library and the immigrants, I help them realize and then accomplish their American dream. During these difficult times, I think our job is more important than ever. I feel it's meaningful for me too.
It does make you feel proud that people like Minjing Lee and other immigrants who come here, when they do something really good for themselves, it feels good that maybe we had a play in that.
Hi, everyone. I'm Susan Latham, Executive Director of the Queens Public Library Foundation. Thanks for being here tonight. I have to say, Jelani, ordering and figuring out and brainstorming and coming up with that golden library card was the most fun part of this entire event. We have been so excited, and so we're happy to have one for all of our honorees. I'm thrilled tonight to have the honor of presenting Minjin Lee with a Queens Public Library Award. Minjin Lee is a best-selling novelist and essayist who was born in Seoul, South Korea, and moved to Elmhurst, Queens with her family when she was 7 years old. She attended the Bronx High School of Science and then Yale College before going to law school at Georgetown University. Min is the author of the novels Free Food for Millionaires, much of which is set in Elmhurst, Queens, and Pachinko, which was a finalist for the National Book Award and a runner-up for the Dayton Literary Peace Prize. Pachinko has been translated into over 35 languages, was on over 75 Best Books of the Year lists, and was recently adapted for a television series on Apple TV. Her fiction explores the intersection of race, ethnicity, immigration, class, religion, gender, and identity of a diasporic people. The New Yorker says Lee's gift is her ability to write sweeping, magisterial books that take on ponderous political themes, the Korean diasporic experience, the invisibility of marginalized groups in history, the limits of assimilation, and to make their unhurried, quiet intrigues read like thrillers. Min's writing has been featured in The New Yorker, The New York Review of Books, One Story, The New York Times Book Review, and The Wall Street Journal. She is the recipient of many awards, and she is currently a writer in residence at Amherst College, as well as serving as a trustee of PEN America and a director of the Authors Guild. She is at work on her third novel, American Hagwon, and a nonfiction work, Name Recognition. It's my pleasure to present the Queens Public Library Award and a Golden Library card to Minjin Lee, who unfortunately is unable to be here with us tonight, but I'm very pleased to share the following message from her. Good evening. I'm humbled and grateful to be included with my fellow honorees, Jelani Cobb, RJ Palacio, and Gary Shteyngart, writers I admire very much. I'm heartbroken to miss tonight. Alas, it was my turn to get COVID, and though I'm on the mend, I thought it would be best to stay in. I want to thank the Queens Public Library and every single person who makes it work so effectively for everyone. I thank the libraries of Queens not just for this great honor, but also for having been my first American friend and teacher. Before I became any kind of writer at all, I was a reader, and I became a great reader because of the Elmhurst Public Library. I want to thank each of you for supporting libraries which serve all of us, including those who are new to America, including those who do not have friends, including those who do not have the English skills to even seek for help. I know that the Queens Public Library does these things because I was new to America. I did not have friends, and I did not have the language. And yet, I was made to feel welcome, and you gave so much to me. Thank you for being gracious and generous to immigrants, refugees, and those without books at home. Thank you for giving the people of Queens a place to learn and grow. I am proud to be a native of the borough of Queens, and even prouder to represent the Queens Public Library. I wish you good health and peace always. And thank you, Min, for that beautiful message. Let's have a round of applause for Minjin Lee.
Before we present our next award, let's visit the McGoldrick Library, where I had worked there in the 90s in Flushing, and learn more about the Queens Public Library's programs for children.
Being a librarian for me, you have an opportunity to help people in so many areas. For example, you can help the child to find information about butterflies, or you can help a young adult how to build a robot. But McGoldrick Library is like a second home for me. I know what the community needs because I'm one of them. I'm an immigrant mom, and I know what kind of thing they might need in a way. Our regular programs are like toddler time, mother goose time, summer reading program, a chess competition, we show movies. Stacks program is after school program. Kids come every day, they get homework help, and after that they do some kind of educational activities. Spelling bee, science project, you know, small experiment they do, and it's very popular here.
What I like the most about Stacks, it is creative, it has people in it, and they are willing to spend their time to help others. And you can actually learn new subjects, how to make these crafts, how to say these poetry. They even have special guests, so that's the specialist part. When you go to the library, it's quiet and you get some space with yourself so you can just pick up a book and read there.
By using the library and opening yourself up to the world of reading, there's so much you can discover about yourself and the world that will enrich your life. From ages birth through sixth grade, we have a little something for everybody. Babies are welcome to come here. The parents read them stories. Kids learn to read in so many different ways. I believe the story times instill a love of stories with children because loving stories and then wanting to be able to read the books, you know, is the incentive for kids. To see them grow and go through the levels that they start out here, then they move to the picture books, then they're into the easy readers. And then when they're ready for the big time, the fiction, or to see a kid, you know, finally get bigger and say, I want to read Wonder. Wonder was one of those books they all heard about at other places, and they'd come in. You just had to make sure you had it in stock and multiple copies.
I'm very proud to know author R.J. Palacio was grew up in this community.
From reading Wonder, I learned that it doesn't matter if you are different because if you are, that just makes you more special. I think it's really cool that she grew up in Queens because maybe if she hadn't grew up here, maybe she wouldn't have made Wonder because the diversity and also like the library, it might have like inspired her too.
I think R.J. Palacio using the Queens Library as a child at McGoldrick is fabulous because it means that if you educate yourself, you can do anything.
What an honor it is to present the next award to R.J. Palacio. R.J. grew up in Flushing. She attended the High School of Art and Design in Manhattan, and then majored in illustration at the Parsons School of Design. Her early works appeared in The Village Voice and the New York Times Book Review, which eventually segued into her more than 25-year career as an art director and graphic designer in the publishing industry. She designed thousands of book covers for writers in every genre of fiction and nonfiction. This year marks the 10th anniversary of RJ's best-selling novel, Wonder, which has helped more than 15 million readers learn about the power of kindness. It has spent over 500 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list and has been translated into 55 languages. Many of those languages we have at the Queens Public Library and has won a number of accolades. It is one of Time's 100 best young adult books of all time, a School Library Journal Best Book of the Year, a Publisher's Weekly Best Children's Book, and more. RJ has written several other New York Times bestselling books, including Pony, 365 Days of Wonder, Mr. Brown's Book of Precepts, Augie and Me, Three Wonder Stories, the picture book We're All Wonders, and the graphic novel White Bird, which is being made into a feature film. RJ, thank you for helping millions of kids understand the importance and power of being kind. It is my great pleasure to present the Queens Public Library Award and a Golden Library Card to RJ Palacio.
I would like to, first of all, thank you for this tremendous honor. As a kid from Flushing, I have to say, I never, ever imagined that I would be lucky enough to be receiving honors like this in my life. And I do so wish that my parents were around to see this, because look, I have a very vivid imagination, and even in my wildest dreams, I would never have imagined all of the wonderful things that have happened in my life, starting with, you know, just having the most amazing family, but then a career in book publishing as a first-generation Colombian girl, to suddenly be, you know, my old job was, you know, I was rubbing shoulders with Thomas Pynchon and Salman Rushdie and editors who had published Jorge Luis Borges and Garcia Marquez. And for me, it was a dream come true. I came from a very literary family. My parents loved books, and I grew up in a house full of books. I mention that only because I want to talk about the McGoldrick branch for a second. Although I was lucky enough to grow up with a family that loved and appreciated books and reading and literature very much, I remember so much that we would go to Northern Boulevard, hang out at the Jack in the Box. This is when I was like 9 or 10, back when, you know, we didn't have scheduled play dates and you would just kind of leave and just go with a bunch of your friends and hang out. And we would go down Northern Boulevard, hit the Jack in the Box, and then we would go to the McGoldrick branch just to hang out, because that's what we did. And again, for me, it was like kind of going home, because I was so familiar with books. But I know that for a fact that most of the friends that I grew up with weren't as lucky as I was. They didn't come from families who, you know, had bookshelves lined with books. And for them, hanging out at the library was kind of a first introduction to the world of books. And we would go and pull down books like Dallaire's Book of Greek Myths and Edith Hamilton's Mythology. And, you know, we would peruse the bookshelves, and it was magical. I mean, it's truly magical what libraries do. They open up these doors for people. They're a reminder of everything that we love and cherish in this world. You know, it's a pathway to new worlds, and it's a pathway to sort of, again, hang out with your friends and just enjoy an afternoon in a safe and welcoming environment. And that's my memory of the McGoldrick. And I just want to thank you all for this wonderful honor and this opportunity. And it was a really, really delicious meal. Thank you. Really appreciate it. Thanks.
Oh my goodness, this is really cool.
Enjoy it.
All right, thank you. Thank you.
And now, let's go to our central library in Jamaica to learn more about our collections. The library, whether it's this space here at the Central Library or any of our 65 other locations, people can feel like they can get the answers that they need. They make themselves very vulnerable. I don't know something. I need to learn more about something. Can you help me? That is very hard, but we try to make it as easy as possible. We have 1.1 million items in this building alone, and over 6 million items in the collection throughout the whole system. In our special collections, we have the Carter G. Woodson Black History Collection, one of the largest circulating collections of Black history in New York City. The Musical Scores Collection is what we believe to be the largest circulating musical scores collection in the country. There have been people that have come from JFK, taxied here, get the musical score that they need, and then go on to do their performance. When you see the riches that are in front of you, that's when you know that you're in a place that really cares about the resources that it's collecting. And with 50% of the borough, of the over 2.4 million people being born outside the United States, that is the strength of the Queens Public Library. It's what gives us our energy, and it is the strength of the staff that work here, that come from the communities to be able to serve their own communities.
That's been our
mantra for the library, and it's really our mission as to, you know, we want to serve the community. We want our collection reflect the community. As an immigrant myself, you're attracted to a place that really includes your culture, your language. Most recently, we unveiled a Bengali collection donated to us from the Consul General of Bangladesh. It is the fourth most spoken language for Queens County. Bangladesh community really clustered around the Jamaica area, which is where Central Library is. So it makes sense for us to create a sense of belonging for the community and then really to reinforce our role as to we speak your language.
I cannot think about a neighborhood with a library right now. When I found some Bengali books, that is really make me excited. And that is also helped me to develop my the next generation, like my daughter, to teach her about my country, my culture, my heritage. A library has one program for the kids to make them prepared before the kindergarten. My daughter has learned a lot of things. It has helped us, the parents as well, come here and see there is something is waiting. This is a wonderful thing for you. There is a lot of things to learn.
Gary Shteyngart came to the library to look for Russian books and then discovered other germ of the library. His story is typical for our customer. They get inspired. We have all those materials in languages that of their choice and then really nourishes people's desire to learn.
Gary Shteyngart was able to have a connection immediately as soon as he walked in the door to see those books in Russian and know, you know what? This space is welcoming me in my own language, whether it's in Bengali, in Spanish, in Russian, in Polish, 50 languages that we have. And we take the people that are welcomed by these languages and work with them to be lifelong learners.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Wanda Chin, Vice President of the Board of Directors of the Queens Public Library Foundation, and I am so pleased to present our last award of the evening to Gary Shteyngart. Gary is a best-selling author known for his humor, his satirical takedowns of contemporary society, and his compassionate examination of modern love and loss. He was born in the former Soviet Union and moved to Little Neck, Queens with his family at the age of 7. He graduated from Stuyvesant High School and Oberlin College in Ohio. Today, he is an associate professor of writing at Columbia University. Gary's books regularly appear on best of lists around the world and have been published in 30 countries. He is the New York Times best-selling author of the memoir Little Failure, which was a National Book Critics Circle Award finalist, and also the author of the novels Super Sad True Love Story, which won the Bollinger Everyman Wodehouse Prize, also Lake Success, Absurdistan, and the Russian Debutante's Handbook, which was the winner of the Stephen Crane Award for First Fiction and the National Jewish Book Award for Fiction. His most recent novel, Our Country Friends, which is on the tables, was an instant New York Times bestseller and was named one of the best books of the year by the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, Time, Kirkus Reviews, and others. New York Times Molly Young called it the perfect novel for these times and all times, the single textual artifact from the pandemic era I would place in a time capsule as a representation of all that is good and true and beautiful about literature. I hope the extraterrestrials who exhume it will agree. Gary, please join me on stage to receive the Queens Public Library Award and your golden library card.
Yeah.
Here's your golden library.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh.
appreciate it. Thank you.
Golden library card. Yeah. I'm going to check out some books. Thank you so much. I'm so glad to be back in my favorite borough by far. Yeah. The hell with you, Brooklyn. Sick of you. I can't afford to live in Brooklyn. I live in Manhattan. This is really an honor. I remember coming to the Queens Public Library because that's where I learned English. And in fact, I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the Queens Public Library. I went to a Hebrew school, a yeshiva, so they certainly were going to teach me English there. And so the Queens Public Library initially baited in my family because they had one of the biggest Russian collections in New York. So if you wanted your fix of Tolstoy and Dostoevsky and Turgenev and Gogol, who, by the way, was born in Ukraine, right? Yeah. Glory to Ukraine! Slava Ukraini! So we would go there for our fix of Russian literature, but eventually, because I went to a Hebrew school, I was trying to figure out who these people were, these Americans, as we called them, and I slowly began to migrate to the young adult fiction part of it, and there I discovered a woman who I've had the incredible pleasure to meet about 5 years ago in her house in Key West. Her name was Judy Bloom. Oh, Maron. This is Judy Bloom. Woofa. I love this Judy Bloom. And it was reading books like that, you know, going up from the very early books to Forever, which taught me all about sexuality. I in fact, have not learned anything since. It's all at the Forever stage. Yeah, the women are laughing. I hear that. The men are like, what's Forever? Well, you're going to learn tonight. And that's where I really not only learned English, but really became, it was my first entree into what America was going to become for me. And it was the very first suggestion that I wasn't going to grow up to be yet another coked up corporate lawyer like everyone else and who went to Stuyvesant, but rather the writer I am today. So I can't believe the honor I've been given today, that giant thing somewhere with the glass and the library card, because honestly, without you, Queens Public Library, my life would have been hell. So thank you so much. I really mean it from the bottom of my heart. You've changed my life and you've made me who I am today. Thank you.
First, can we give another round of applause to all of our honorees? It has been a fantastic evening. I want to thank all of them, Jelani, Minjin, RJ, and Gary, for your words. And your words were really extremely important to all of us. And also the video reminders of the diversity of the Queens Public Library. And that, to me, is who we are as a borough, who we are as a city, but more importantly, who we are as a library. And the growth of the Queens Public Library would not be possible without our great board of trustees, our great board of foundation directors, and our fantastic staff. And can we give the staff who are here and those who are not here a big thanks? And I am pleased to announce to all of you, as a result of your support and the support of others for tonight's event, we have raised almost $435,000 for the library's programs and services. Unrestricted money to allow us to do creative things to really reach people in the community. And I say a big thank you. And if you're still interested in donating and giving and telling others about us, and you'd like to raise even more, I hope you consider making a donation to the Queens Public Library Foundation. Just click on the QR code. Thank you for being here. We believe in being timely. Enjoy the rest of the night, and thank you for your support. Enjoy.